सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। नमः श्री शंकरानंद नमः श्री शंकरानंद गुरुपादाम्बुजन्मने गुरुपादाम्बुजन्मने सविलास महामोह सविलास महामोह ग्राहग्रासैककर्मणे ग्राहग्रासैककर्मणे।
Advaitananda Prakaranam is the chapter where the author shows how Ananda, Brahma, which is of the nature of Ananda, is Advitiyam, is non-dual. And that is possible only when Brahma is a material cause. If Brahma or God were merely the efficient cause, meaning that the creator and the creation were separate from each other, then certainly there would be duality. The non-duality is possible only when the creator also is the material cause. That's the whole idea. The advitiyatma, the non-duality, can be shown only when Brahman is both nimitta and upadana karana, meaning it is both the maker and the product, the creator as well as the creation. And that's the point that is being made here. Then, in order to explain what kind of upadanam or material cause Brahma is, he also introduces this prevalent view that the material cause or cause is looked upon in three ways. Upadanam tridha bhinnam. That upadanam or the material cause is of three kinds. Vivarti parinamicha arambhakamcha. Vivarti upadana karanam, parinami upadana karanam, arambhaka upadana karanam. What is arambha? Arambha means the beginning or the commencement. So, seventh verse said, arambhavadino nyasmad anyasyot patti muchire. So, this arambhavadina, the people who say that the cause of the creation is the arambhopadana karanam, meaning the creation has a beginning. So, they say that any creation has a beginning. So, when a part comes into being, a non-existent part comes into existence. A part that was non-existent in clay comes into existence, this is what they say. And therefore, wherever any creation is, they say that the creation always is something new, meaning that something that was non-existent in the cause comes into being. So whether they look upon the creation of a part from the clay, or from cloth, or creation of a cloth, from the yarn, whichever way. Tantoho patasya nishpattehe. So this, as we said yesterday, is called asat-kari-vada. That kārya, the effect, is asat, non-existent in the cause. Tantoho patasya nishpattehe. How pata or the cloth is created from tantu or the yarn or the thread? Bhinnau tantu patau khalu. They say that the cloth and the thread are indeed two separate entities. Cloth is not thread and thread is not cloth. Why is it so? Because viruddha parinamatvat viruddhartha kriyavatvacha. Number one, as we said yesterday, if cloth and the thread both were one, then just as the thread gives rise to the cloth also should give rise to the cloth. It doesn't happen. And secondly, the thread has one kind of use, cloth has a different kind of use. Thread can be used in making cloth or rope, etc., whereas a cloth is used for covering the body, protecting the body, and therefore, artha kriya karitvam, even their usefulness also is different, and what they produce or what they are cause of, that is also different, and therefore, cloth is not part, part is not cloth. This totally pragmatic viewpoint. How do you understand the reality of a thing from its usefulness? How useful a thing is, or what is its use? That is how we determine the reality of a thing. All the Nyayikas do. So according to them, the flower is real, the water is real, the table is real, because all of them serve a purpose. Only Miraj water will be called unreal by them, because it does not serve a purpose. So anything that serves a purpose is called real by them. And accordingly, to them, cloth is real. If cloth is real, that means it is an independent entity. So cotton also is real, and cloth also is real. A real cloth has come into being. If cloth is real, then it has to be independent. Its reality must be independent. So they say that a non-existent cloth comes into being. This is called Arambhavada. So these Vaisheshikas, they say that the universe is a product of the five atoms. So they are the atomic scientists, that space, air, fire, water and earth, these five atoms, they are the cause of this creation. Now, what is the Parinama? Parinami, the Sankhyas are called Parinamavadinaha. They are called Satkaryavadinaha. They say that the effect is there in the cause. So they do not say that a new effect is created. They say that the effect is potentially there in the cause. Like the pot is potentially there in the clay. Then the Vaisheshikas ask, if the pot is already in the clay, then what's the need for you to do all this, make an effort on the part of the pot maker to create the pot? If the pot is already in the clay, what's the need of that effort? So since an effort is needed, we say the pot which was not there comes into being. That's how the Vaisheshikas justify saying that a non-existent pot has come into existence. So what do the Sankhyas say? The Satkaryavadinaha, those people who say that the effect was potentially there in the cause, what do they say? Says not that, so effort of the pot maker is not in terms of bringing into existence a non-existent pot, but the effort of the pot maker is bringing into manifestation an unmanifest pot. So they say that creation is from unmanifest to the manifest, and not from non-existent to the existence. See, there is a lot of difference. The Vaisheshikas say the creation is from non-existence to existence, whereas the Sankhyas say that creation is from unmanifest to manifest. So how do you look upon the effort of a pot maker? What exactly does a pot maker do? One set of people say that pot maker brings into existence a non-existent pot. The other people say the pot maker brings into manifestation an unmanifest pot. So pot was there in the unmanifest state. Vedantins also accept this viewpoint of Satkaryavada, meaning the potential existence of the effect in the cause, as far as the Vyavaharik Satta is concerned. For Sankhyas, this is Paramadhi Satta. For Sankhyas, the world is reality. The effect is reality. That we don't accept. But as far as our Vyavahara is concerned, we do accept the Satkaryavada, meaning that the effect is potentially there in the cause. Shiram dadhisyat, mrut kumbhasyat, suvarnam kundalam nithasyat. Just as the milk becomes a curd, gets transformed into curd. So when a substance gives up its previous state and attains a new state, that is called the parinama. Thus milk gives up its previous state of milkness and attains a new state of curdness. So we say that milk has undergone a transformation in the form of curd. Mrut kumbha, the clay becomes a pot. The clay lump is transformed into a pot. Suvarnam kundalam yatha, or gold becomes ornament. So this is the example of Parinamavada. Parinami upadana karanam. Then in the ninth verse, the example of Vivarta upadana karanam is given. So Sankhya say that wherever creation is, there is always the cause undergoing a transformation to become the effect. The Vaisheshikas will say wherever the creation is, always a non-existent effect comes into existence. Sankhyas will say an unmanifest effect comes into manifestation. What will a Vedantin say? Vedantins will say that the cause only appears as an effect. This is how the Vedantins will say. Avasthantara bhanam tu vivarto rajju sarpavat. Stu purvavastham aparityajyeva avasthantara bhanam vivartaha. So Vedantins talk about a third kind of a material cause, or a third explanation of the creation. These three are really explanations of the process of creation. So explanation of Vaisheshikas, explanation of the Sankhyas, explanation of Vedanta is what? That a cause doesn't undergo any change, or neither a non-existent effect comes into existence, nor does the cause undergo a real change. We say that the cause appears as an effect. Purvam avastham aparityajya. That a substance without really giving up its previous state, avasthantarabhanam vivartaha, that it in fact appears to assume a new state. Where do you find it? Rajju sarvavata. Yatha rajjvatmana avasthitasyeva dravyasya sarpatmana avabhasanam vivartaha. Just as a substance that previously obtained in the state of being a rope appears to be a snake. So thus that substance in a rope, without giving up its nature of ropeness, appears as a snake. So this one thing appearing as something else is called vivarta. Now, even if we accept those fellows, suppose we accept the Vaisheshikas, that in some cases it is a non-existent effect that comes into existence. And we accept the Sankhyas also that in the creation, the substance undergoes the transformation to become the effect. Suppose we accept both of these standpoints, then also we say that as far as Brahma is concerned, none of these explanations would be acceptable or would be applicable. But before that, so says Nanu Vivartamanasya Rajvadehe Sam Shatvadarshanat Niramsya Sopina Khadadidi Ashankhya. It's all right. See, the example that you gave was that of, as far as the example of Vivarta Upadana Karana is concerned, the example that you gave is the one of Rajju and Sarpa, the rope and the snake. All right, the rope appearing as a snake. But that's okay. Understand that rope is a composite entity, meaning rope is made up of so many parts. It's made up of strands. And strand is again a composite entity. It's made up of cotton, again a composite entity, made up of fibers. Again, a composite entity, made up of molecules. In short, the examples that you are giving of a substance appearing something else, like a rope appearing as a snake, is an example of a substance that is composite, is called savayava, having parts, meaning being a composite entity. But that means that which is a composite entity alone can become the cause, vivarta upadana karanam. It can become the cause in the form of vivarta. But niramshe, suppose there is some substance that is partless. Is it possible for the superimposition to take place on something that is partless or formless? See, you are giving example of, ultimately we want to show how the whole creation is a superimposition upon Brahma. But what's the nature of Brahma? Brahma is a homogeneous, partless principle. And therefore, the examples that you are giving are all examples of entities which are composite entities. Like superimposition of snake upon the rope, or superimposition of silver upon the mother of pearl, and whatnot. But the rope also is a composite entity, that mother of pearl also is a composite entity. But Brahman, on the other hand, is nirvayava, meaning it is partless. And therefore, how can these examples be applicable to Brahman? Just because you prove the superimposition. So we say that all creation is projection of superimposition. But you are proving superimposition in case of entities that are composite. You cannot extend that same argument to Brahman, which is not composite, which is partless. So can you give an example of the superimposition taking place in something that is formless or partless? It says, niravayave gaganadavapi taddashanatmayavam. So Vedantins give this example always of, yes, superimposition can take place even on a substratum that is formless or partless. And where do you find it? Space. So they always give the example of space. So the second line of the verse is niramshepyastyasau vyomni talamalinya kalpanat asau niramshe vyomni abhyasti asau vivartaha. This superimposition is also found in vyoma. Vyoma meaning the space. And what is space? Is formless. Space doesn't have any form. Space is not a composite entity. It is partless or formless entity. and in space also we find superimposition taking place. In short, even though if you are not satisfied with the example of rope, because the rope is a composite entity, now we are giving an example of space, which is a formless or a partless entity. And even space can also become substratum for superimposition. Asau vivartaha vyomni talatvam adhomukhendra neelakataha tulyatvam malinyam neelavarnata tayoho kalpanat talamalinya kalpanat. Some people feel that space has a shape. See, when you look at the sky really is formless. And see, how do we feel? That the sky meets the earth. So there is a horizon where the sky is meeting the earth. So earth has a surface and sky also has a surface. So to us, the sky appears to have a surface. In fact, sky is formless. It cannot have a surface. And still we find, talam means what? Tala means a surface. Adho mukhendra neela kataha tulyatvam. It's like a great big frying pan. An inverted frying pan, imagine. So kataha means a frying pan, a huge inverted frying pan. A huge inverted blue frying pan. That is how the form of the space looks. So the people who do not know. So akasha sarva anabhignehi aropyamanatvat. People who do not know the nature of space, they believe that space really has a shape like this, which is like an inverted frying pan. Or malinyam. Some people believe that space is colored. So they believe that space has blue color. And thus, that idea of the color also is superimposed upon space. And space is what? Formless. Space is partless. So see, space is an example where the substratum is formless or partless. So substratum of superimposition is formless. Space is an example. So that example can be extended to Brahman, which is also formless. So that's why it says here that we have even an example or illustration of how superimposition takes place upon even a partless entity such as space. Neelavarnata tayoho kalpana akasha sarva anabhignehi aropyamanatvaditartha. As people who are unaware of the nature of the space, they think or they superimpose the space having a particular form or a surface and space having color. The space which is partless or formless becomes substratum for superimposition of ideas of a shape or a color. And so, what is the result of this discussion? The 10th verse says, Tato niramsha anande, tato niramsha anande, vivarto jagadishyadam, vivarto jagadishyadam, maya shakti kalpikasyad, maya shakti kalpikasyad, aindra jalika shaktivad, aindra jalika shaktivad. Tatah niramshe anande vivartah jagadishyatam. Tatah niramshe bhi vivarta sambhavat. Since we have shown that how vivarta or superimposition is possible on an entity like space, which is niramsha or partless or formless, so we say that niramshe anande vivartah ishyatam. We say that ananda or Brahman, which is partless or formless, vivartah kalpitah iti angikaryam ityarthah. So we would accept that superimposition of this jagat or the universe is possible upon Brahma, that is partless or formless. The thing is that as far as the parinama is concerned, as far as the transformation is concerned, transformation can only take place in an entity which is composite. Space cannot get transformed into anything, because when can transformation happen? For example, when can milk undergo a transformation into curd? When milk, as we said yesterday, is made up of different components, like molecules. And those molecules get transformed into some other kinds of molecules because of the bacterial action, and that's how we have what we call curd. So milk being composite entity can get transformed into another entity, and thus parinama is possible only in a composite entity. How about Arambha? Arambha meaning creation of such thing as pot or cloth, even that is also possible in clay or cotton, which are also composite entities. So Parinama or Arambha are not possible in case of an entity that is partless. Whereas Vivarta or superimposition is possible even in case of an entity that is partless. So we say that Brahman that is partless or formless may be accepted as the substratum for the superimposition of this whole creation. Niramshe, so Vivarta Samavad, Jagat Niramshe Anande Vivarta Kalpita Iti Angikari Mityardha, and so we have to accept that this creation is superimposed upon Brahman or Ananda, which is Niramsha or partless. Okay, so that is done. That's how we prove or we show how the Brahman is Advitiya, meaning non-dual. This is the whole point of the 6th chapter of Chandogya Upanishad. The proposition there is how everything can be known by knowing one. This is how Uddalaka, the father, asks his son Shvetaketu. When Shvetaketu returned from his teacher's home and was graduate and very proud of his knowledge, and now his father was, he thought that his father doesn't know anything, so he was very proud of his own knowledge and learning. So did not even properly respect his father. So father noticed this and called him, says, "Son, looks like you are very proud and you are very arrogant, you can't even bend down. Looks like you must have some one important, wonderful knowledge." Uttadam adesham apraksi, said, "Did you ask your teacher of that instruction?" Yena ashrutam shrutam bhavati amatam matam avijnatam vijnatam iti. So I'm sure that you know something wonderful because of which you are so proud. Did you ask of your teacher instruction of that knowledge, knowing which everything becomes as well, hearing which everything as well becomes heard, reflecting on which everything becomes reflected, knowing which everything becomes known? Surely you must be knowing that. The reason, that's why you seem to be very proud. Then Shvetaketu says, "What is that thing? This I never knew. I don't know. My teacher has not taught me that. I don't think my teacher knew that." He was now afraid that his father will send him back to school, because he has not learned this. And therefore, immediately he gave a justification of why he did not know that. Because my teacher has not taught me, and he would have taught me if he knew it also. So I don't think that my teacher also knows that. And then he requests his father, "Then will you please teach me? How can it be that knowing one thing, everything can also become known?" Then the teacher gives the example. Yatha ekena mrutpindana sarvam mrunmayam vijnatam syad. Just by knowing one clod of earth, how everything that is made of earth is as well known. Or by knowing one particle of gold, how everything made of gold is as well known. Or by knowing one particle of iron, how everything made of iron also is known. So there are examples of iron, So what is the age of the Vedas? That's why they say the Vedas have only come after the Iron Age, because of illustrations of iron there, and things like that. So it's an interesting way of fixing of the age, of different scriptures. And so the pratignya or the promise, the proposition in Chandogya Upanishad is, by knowing one thing, everything as well becomes known. And how can it be? Only when there is one entity. Only when one entity alone appears as many, then alone by knowing one, that will know everything. And that's how that one entity is Brahman, and that alone appears as the whole universe. And therefore, knowing Brahman, you will know everything. So this is how the whole theme is developed in the 6th chapter of the Upanishad. So the reason why it is shown here, or the reason why this whole point is made, that how the creation is a superimposition upon Brahman, is to show that it is mithya and Brahman is satyam, is to prove the non-duality of Brahman. So that by knowing Brahman the cause, everything that is in effect is as well known. Okay, svadvitiyatvam or the non-duality of Brahman has been shown. Now the next question arises. When you try to prove one thing, then some other questions will arise. ननु अद्वितीये आनंदे जगत कल्पनम अनुपपन्नम कल्पना हेतोः अभावात्। मोमेंट यू से दैट ब्रह्मन इज वन विदाउट अ सेकंड, देयर इज नथिंग बट ब्रह्मन, देयर इज गॉड अलोन, ऑल दैट गॉड अलोन इज, देन क्वेश्चन इज, इफ ब्रह्मन इज वन विदाउट अ सेकंड बिफोर द क्रिएशन, हाउ डज द क्रिएशन कम अबाउट? Who brings about the creation? For superimposition, something is required. If there is a rope, you require someone other than rope in order to superimpose a snake upon the rope. Or there must be some kind of inherent power in the rope, something must be there by which this snake is projected. Who is there? Even the Brahman alone is there. Who will project this jagat? So when there is all that is Brahman, which is not one without a second, that's all there is, then how do you explain the projection of this world or universe on Brahman? Nanu advitiye anande jagat kalpanam anupannam, that this projection of the creation in Brahman that is non-dual is not tenable. Kalpana hetoho abhavat, because there is nothing that actually will bring about this projection. Iti ashankya hai. So this question is answered in the second line of the verse. Maya shakti kalpikasyat ऐन्द्रजालिक शक्तिवत है। माया शक्ति ही कल्पिका स्यात्। We say that माया शक्ति ही, it is a power called माया, which is कल्पिका, which is the projectress, you know, the creatress or the projectress, whatever you call it. So, it is माया शक्ति or the power called माया is that which is agent of this superimposition. Shakti kalpakatvam kvadrushtam. Where do you find that the shakti or the power is able to project? That this power has, the shakti or the power can become the agent of projection. Where did you find that? Aindrajalika shaktivada. So Indrajala, Indrajala means maya or the magic. Aindrajalika means a magician. Aindrajalika shaktivada. Like the power of a magician. So how the power inherent in a magician actually brings about a projection of variety of things. Yatha aindrajalika nishthayaha mani mantradi rupayaha mayayaha shakteh. See, the magicians, how do they do these things? They have some power. Mani mantradi rupayaha shakteh. Either there is some power of mani, meaning they have some magical stones like Chandrakanta mani. So, or mani means a precious stone. And so Chandrakanta mani, supposed to be mani, which can bring about, which can bring about some effects, like it will obstruct the power of fire and things like that. So there are certain mani and certain mantras are there, certain incantations are there, which have the power to create things. So perhaps the magicians have this kind of power of some mantras or some other things they have, because of which they will create things. In fact, Swami Vivekananda once was describing in his lecture that he experienced, he met many people having a wonderful variety of powers. He says, once he was traveling in India those days and he went to Hyderabad, and then he heard of a Pandit who was very learned and who was known to have some unusual powers to create things. So he says, all right, we went to see this Pandit and requested him to show his powers. This man was suffering from fever. Anyway, after a couple of days, he called them. Then he had almost recovered from the fever. And so then he was sitting in one place and asked them to cover him with a bed sheet. Okay. Then he says, all right, now ask of anything that you want. Whatever fruits you want, you ask of. So these people ask for various fruits, like mango and all kinds of fruits and many other fruits which never grow in that region. And this Brahmin produced all kinds of juicy, fresh fruits, from under his bed sheet, and in plenty of quantities, not just one or two. Then they asked for different flowers, and he brought all flowers, fresh roses, with the honeydews on them, also that kind of fresh roses, and these flowers also he produced. It's not merely for the show. He said, you can eat that fruit. These fellows were somewhat reluctant. He said, don't worry. He started eating the mango. These people also ate the mango, and it was real mango. They could eat it. So all kinds of powers are there. In Calcutta, he says, we went to some other people. So here we went to this man, and this man gave them a piece of paper and says, you write something. And They wrote, each one of them wrote things in different languages. Swami Vivekananda wrote something in Sanskrit, and somebody wrote in Arabic, somebody wrote in Persian. None of these languages this person knew, and still he could tell them exactly what they had written in those pieces of paper. And in fact, he later on asked them, all right, then he himself wrote something. No, it's like this. He wrote something in the papers. He folded and gave to all of them. Okay? And then after 10 minutes is all right, each of you think of a sentence in whichever language you want. So they thought of a sentence. He says, now you open your papers. They opened the papers and found that same sentence was written in Arabic, in Sanskrit, in Persian, all these languages. So they were all flabbergasted, you know. So all kinds of powers people seem to possess. And these powers may be there because of certain upasanas, because of certain meditations and whatever. And by the powers you get due to either powers of the mind, powers of some mantra. Because in the scriptures we find, in Indian scriptures, all kinds of weapons, all kinds of missiles, the Agni, all kinds of Shastra missiles are there, and they were all supposed to be powers of mantra. Anyway, yatha aindrajalaganishthayaha mani mantrayadirupayaha mayayaha shaktehe, because of the shakti of the power of the nature of either mani, meaning a jewel, or mantra, meaning incantations, so powers residing in the magicians in the form of mani or the mantra, how that power brings about Gandharva Nagaradi Kalpakatvam, how that brings about the Gandharva Nagar. He can create before you a city, and that may look to you like a real city. And so how the power of magic or power of mantra or the mani inherent in a magician, how that power creates like Gandharva Nagar, a magical city. Similarly also, this power called Maya brings about this whole universe. That's the reason why the word Maya is used. Maya really means magic. And how magician brings into existence thing that is not there at all. At least brings into appearance something which is not there at all. And so similar also is the creation, which is appearance of something which is not substantially there. So now, in order to explain the superimposition, they bring in the concept of Maya. We already told you what is Maya is, a concept that is introduced in order to explain things, that's all. Not that Vedantins have any love for Maya or things like that. But the point is that once you explain and understand, at least you will be free from the botheration and you will do what is to be done. And that's the only purpose of this Maya, not to give it any reality, but to be able to explain what we are experiencing. I told you the other day the story of the 18th elephant. So how the 18th elephant was introduced to solve the problem. Like the rich man, when he died, he left lots of property, which was all divided among the three of his sons. And among properties, he also had an elephant stable where he had elephants, which also he said that these two sons should divide. The eldest son should get one half of the number of elephants. The second son should get one third of all the elephants. And the third son should get one ninth of all the elephants. So when they go and count the elephants, they find 17 elephants. And how can 17 be divided like one half and one third and one ninth? They were all puzzled. So in the meantime, when they were wondering what to do about it, how our father was so intelligent, how can he make such a mistake? They couldn't understand. So in the meantime, they found the minister of that town was passing by on his elephant, and he asked his boys, what's happening? What's the problem? Then they related that problem. Minister says, no problem. Take my elephant, okay? Take it. So now there were 18 elephants. And so the eldest son took half of them, so 9. The second son took one third, 6. The third son took one ninth, 2. So 9 plus 6 plus 2, 17. Still there, the 18th elephant was spared. This fellow took it back and then went away. So this is how, just as the 18th elephant is introduced in order to solve a given problem, and so also to solve the problem of perception of this universe, solve the problem of the duality, solve the problem of creation. So all these problems are there, and since the student who approaches the teacher naturally is concerned, is pained perhaps and has fought and all kinds of conflicts are there, and naturally the world is responsible for all my problems, and therefore an explanation for the world has to be given. Then the student understands, okay, now I understand. And once he understands, then all right, he can drop and he can focus his attention to that which is reality. So anyway, the concept of Maya is introduced in order to explain how the superimposition of the universe comes about. But the moment you talk of Maya, the next question is, so we said that Brahman is advitiyam or non-dual, in order to prove that Ananda is one without, is complete. That brought the problem of creation, so we said, all right, it is Maya which brings about the superimposition. Then the question is, now you have Brahman and then you have Maya. That means there are two factors, and therefore you are talking of duality.
Nanu Anandatma Atiriktayaha Mayayaha Abhivagame
Dvaitapattihi. If you say that there is Maya, which is other than Ananda or Brahma, in that case, you will have to accept the duality, because Brahma is one principle and Maya is another principle. So now that you are talking about a power called Maya, and if this Maya is something independent of Brahma, then you will have two separate, two independent entities, and therefore Dvaitapattihi. There is this apatti on the occasion of duality. Iti asankhya. So what will Vedantin say?
Tasyaha anirvachaniyatvena anrutattvam vaktum.
Vedantin say that the relationship between Brahma and Maya is anirvachaniya, meaning is non-definable. We saw this in Viveka Chudamani. Sannapya sannapya bhayatmikano bhinnapya bhinnapya bhayatmikano sangapya nangapya bhayatmikano Mahadbhutanir Vachaniya Rupa. Question is this Maya real or is there or not there? So take the case of a rope snake. Ask this question, is a snake there or not? You cannot say the snake is not, because had it not been, you would not have perceived it. You cannot say the snake is, because if it is, then of course it should always be there. And when you show the torchlight, the snake is not there. Since when the torchlight is shown there, the snake is not there, you cannot say that it is there. However, since you perceive the snake, so you cannot say it is not there. So sanna pisanna, you cannot say it is there, nor can you say it is not there, nor can you say it is there and not there, because two contradictory things cannot be. Bhinnapya bhinnapya bhayatmikano. Would you say that the snake is separate from the rope, or snake is one with the rope? If the snake is separate from the rope, then the snake enjoys a separate existence, in which case it's a real snake. But the fact that it disappears when you show the torchlight, you cannot say that it is real there. Would you say that then the snake is one with the rope? If the snake is not separate from the rope, would you say that the snake is identical to the rope? We can't say that, because we are able to perceive the rope independently without the snake. So the snake can be completely negated. So you cannot say that the snake is identical to the rope, and you cannot say the snake is separate from the rope. What is the relationship between the rope and the snake? Anirvachaniya, that which cannot be categorized. So Vedantin's one answer to everything is anirvachaniyam. And that is exactly what the scientists tell us today, that everything is anirvachaniyam. Is it particle? Is it wave? Is it mass? Is it velocity? Momentum? What is it? All anirvachaniyam. So probabilities and all these, in this language, they express anirvachaniyatvam. Tasyaha anirvachaniyatvena anrutattvam vaktum. That is, Maya is not a real entity. It is anruta, meaning it is unreal, and therefore it does not count a second. As we said the other day, that when you made 100,000 ornaments from gold, when you count gold, how all the ornaments get counted? And similarly also, because the names and forms do not stand apart from the substance. What you call ornament is nothing but gold with a name and form. But remove the gold from that ornament, do the name and form remain independent of that? No, the names and forms also disappear. And therefore, Maya, just as the name and form is not separate from the gold, so also Maya does not enjoy an existence separate from Brahma. Therefore, it cannot be counted as second, and therefore, introduction of this concept of Maya does not bring in duality. Now, in order to say this, first of all, what the author does, उत्तरत्र वक्ष्यमाणायाः लौकिक्याः अज्ञादिशक्तेः तावद् भेदेन अभेदेन वा निर्वक्तुम् अशक्यत्वं दर्शयति. We say that, what is the relationship between Shakti and Shaktiman? Shaktiman, one possessed of power. Shakti means the power. What is the relationship between the power and the powerful? Does that power stand apart from the one who possesses the power? Or is that power identical to the one possessing the power? Or what is the relationship between them? So, we find that even that also we cannot determine. And in order to show this, is the next verse here.
Shakti shaktat prathang nasti, shakti shaktat prathang nasti, tadvad drushter na chabhida, tadvad drushter na chabhida, pratibandasya drushtatvad, pratibandasya drushtatvad, shakti bhave tu kasya saha, shakti bhave tu kasya saha. Shakti hi shaktat prathang nasti, tadvad drushte he. Shakti hi the power. Shaktat, from the one possessed of the power, prathang nasti, it is not separate. Tadvad drushte he, because that is how we see. Shakti hi agnyadi nishtha, sphotadi janika shakti, shaktat agnyadi swarupat prathak bhede nasti. The example is given of fire. And the power that the fire possesses. This fire is an example, illustration. Fire possesses the power. Our daha, it can burn. So sphota, it can also create the sound. So when the fire burns, then there is a sound also. Also, when the fire burns, it has the ability to burn, the power to burn. So let us say that the fire has the power to burn. So there is fire, which is the substance, or the one possessed of that power, and then there is a burning power, which is the power of the fire. So fire and the burning power, what is the relationship between them? Number one, we say that the burning power is not separate from fire. Because we never see burning taking place where fire is not. Agni swarupat prasak bhedena nasti. We say that this burning power is not separate from fire. Kutahaiti. Why do you say that? Because tadvat drishtehe. Tadvat tasatvasya bhedena asatvasya drishtehe darshanat. Agnyadi swarupatirekena anupalabhimanatvaditya. We find that the burning power never obtains independent of fire. Where fire is not, there is no burning. So can you ever find that some burning happens without the fire? The burning power is not separate from fire. If burning power were separate from the fire, then burning can take place without the fire also. So we say that the burning power is not separate from fire because we never see burning taking place independent of fire. Or there is no burning power where the fire is not. So burning power is not found to be there without the fire. So the burning power is not separate from fire. Alright. Napi agnyadi swarupameva shaktihi. Would you then say that the power to burn is identical to fire? So these are all the arguments of the Nayayikas. Vedantins really don't accept the separation between the power and the powerful or the quality of the substance, but at the moment we are accepting the position of the Nayayikas or the Vaisheshikas, who accept that the power is different from the one possessed of the power. So we are just using their arguments here. Navi agnyadi swarupameva shaktihi. Nor can we say that the power to burn is identical to fire. Meaning, where the fire is, that the power to burn must necessarily be there, is not so. Where the burning power is, the fire must necessarily be there. But where the fire is, the burning power may not even be there. Therefore, we say that
burning power cannot be said to be one with the fire. Nacha abhida meaning abhida abhedopi nacha naiva. You cannot say that the fire and the burning power are non-separate. That also you cannot say. That the burning power is not separate because burning power does not obtain without the fire. You cannot say that the burning power is separate from fire, but nor can you say that burning power is one with fire, because you find the separation also. How do you find? Pratibandhasya drishtatva, the second line says, because we find sometimes pratibandha or obstruction. Mani mantra adibhi shakti karyasya sphotadehe pratibandha darshanat swarupa atirikta shakti drishtavyayati abhiprayah. Mani mantra adibhi shakti karyasya sphotadehe pratibandha darshanat. Now this is all seen in India. In the instant time, this must be quite prevalent. Now you can actually obstruct the burning power of fire by incantations or by Chandrakanta Mani. Even today also in India and in many other places also, in fact, these kind of acts are performed where people walk on fire. People walk on fire, and some people known to me also have gone through this kind of experiences where on certain religious occasions, these people are asked to perform fast for 15 days and do some mantra japa or whatever it is. On the 15th day, in public, some festival takes place where they light the fire and these people walk over the fire. Nothing happens to them. That shows that there is something by which the burning power of burning the fire is obstructed. Fire is there, you can see that, and still it does not burn. Pratibandhasya drishtatva. So since we find that fire is there and still it does not burn, therefore we say that the fire, the power to burn is separate from fire. Why separate? Because fire is there and still the power is not there. Therefore we say that the power to burn is not one identical to fire, at least. It is not identical to fire. You cannot say that it is separate from fire, nor can you say it is identical to fire.
Bhavatu pratibandha darshanam shaktehe bhedo vimabhut ko dosha.
Just a question is asked. All right, suppose this kind of an obstruction, the burning power is seen, but then we say that shaktehe bhedo vimabhut. But still, why can it not be that the burning power is still one with the fire? Why can it not be? Because shakti bhave tu kasya sah. Somebody says there is no separate shakti, that the fire does not have a power to burn. Just there is fire. Suppose when you find that there is an obstruction to the power of burning, why don't you say that the power is not there? So shakti abhavetu kasya saha. But the point is that when the fire is burning and because of the certain chanting or because of the effect of certain mani, when the fire does not burn, then naturally there is an obstruction. If you don't accept the burning power which is obstructed, then what is obstructed? What has this incantation or this money done? It must have obstructed something. And that something that is obstructed is the power of the fire. And then pratyaksha siddhasya agnyadi swarupasya pratibandha asambhavat. Because we find that even this mantra, etc., the fire remains, fire is still burning. And so the mantra, etc., have not obstructed the very nature of fire, the swarupa of the fire. And still they have obstructed its burning capacity. Therefore we say that the burning power or burning capacity is a power that is not one with fire.
Shakti anabhivagame sadi pratibandhopi nirvishasyade abhiprayah.
On the other hand, if you don't accept the burning power in fire, then what is it that this pratibandha or obstruction has done? It hasn't done anything. So you accept that there is this power of burning the fire possesses, which is obstructed by such things as mani, mantra, etc. And that being the case, you cannot say that the power is one with the fire, because fire can obtain without the power also. Nor can you say that the power is separate from fire, because fire power is never seen as independent of fire. You never see burning taking place without the fire. So you can't say it is bhinna, separate, nor can you say abhinna, non-separate. What will you say? Anirvachaniya. So thus, here the author shows how the power, the relation of power and the powerful, or the one possessed of the power, is anirvachaniya or is indefinable, indescribable. Well, the same point is clarified further. Nanu atindriyayaha shaktehe katham pratibandho avagantum shakyate iti ashankyah. See, fire is something that is evident to the perception, to the eyes. But that burning power is not evident. See, fire you can see. You cannot see the burning power. So how do you say that the burning power is obstructed because you don't see it? When you don't see something, how do you know that it is obstructed? So the question is, you are saying that this mani or the mantra are able to obstruct the burning power. But can you see burning power? No. If you cannot see burning power, how do you say that this mani or the mantra have obstructed that? And so that question is answered in the 12th verse.
Shakteh karyanumeyatvad, shakteh karyanumeyatvad, akarye pratibandhanam, akarye pratibandhanam, jvalatognerdahe syad, jvalatognerdahe syad, mantradipratibandhata, mantradipratibandhata. Shaktehe karyanumeyatvad, atindriyabhishakti yatah karyalinga gamya atah akarye pratibandhanam sati abhi karyanupattau satyam pratibandhanam pratibandha avagamyadeti sheshah. We say that the power inherent in a thing is only to be inferred from the effect that it produces. So power is inferred from the effect that is produced. Because we see an effect being produced, therefore we accept that there must be power. How? Uktamartham drishtanda pradarshanena spashtayati jvalatah agnehe adahe syat mantradi pratibandhata. Same example. Lokesh swarupena jvalatah agnehe sakashat dahadi lakshane karya anupadyamane sati. Normally the fire burns, but when that burning power is obstructed, we find the fire is not able to burn. So from that we infer that there is a power called burning power in the fire. That the burning takes place, and from that we infer the existence of burning power in the fire. And also, the obstruction of that fire takes place, obstruction of that power takes place, and then we find absence of burning. So this enables us to see or infer the existence of burning power in fire. So fire is evident, perceptible, the burning power is not perceptible. So burning power is something that infer from the presence or absence of the effect.
Dahadi lakshane karye anupadyamane sati mantradi pratibandhata mantradinam shakti pratibandhakatvam syad ityadaha. And thus when you find that the burning power is obstructed, we realize that the mani or the mantra have the capability of obstructing the power, and thus we infer the existence of power from the effect. Okay. So these two verses were devoted to showing how there is what we call shakti or the power, that's all. Ittam laukika shaktim sarupatah pramanatascha upanyasya. In this manner, the author has shown how there is laukika shakti, meaning how the various substances in the world have certain powers. Like wind has a power to blow, fire has a power to burn, water has a power to wet or quench the thirst, earth has a power to support. Thus everything has a power. Even rope also has the power to bind, rope also has the power to project snake. Everything in the world is possessed of some power. And we infer the presence of that power. We see the substance all right, we don't see the power, but the existence of power is inferred from the effect that it creates. So thus, laukika shaktim swarupatah pramanatascha upanyasya. How that these substances in the world possess certain powers is shown by swarupa, by its nature as well as by inference. Idani maya shakti. But now, how do you say that there is power called maya? Where did you learn that? See, inference alone is not acceptable. We must have pramanam here. So pramanam is Upanishad. So Upanishad says that Brahman is possessed of
the Shakti called Maya. Te dhyana yoga anugata pasyan devatma shaktim swagunair nigudham. This is an Upanishad called Shveta Shvatara Upanishad, which specifically talks about the Maya Shakti. Mayam tu prakritam vidyat mayinam tu maheshwaram. May you understand that the Maya is the material cause of this creation? Mayinam tu maheshwaram. And the Maya, the one possessed with the Maya, is called Maheshwara, or the Lord. So great Lord is a Mayavi, the possessed of the power of Maya, and Maya is the material cause. And also says Shvetashvatara Upanishad, Te dhyana yoga anugataha apashyan. Those sages, dhyana yoga anugataha, those sages, when they attain a certain state of concentration of the mind, then apashyan, they saw, what did they see? Devatma shaktim svagunaihi nigunham devatma shaktim apashyan. They in fact saw the devatma shaktim, they saw the shakti of the power that is maya, svagunaihi nigunham. This power of maya, which is of the self, which is normally hidden behind the gunas or the modifications of sattva, rajas, tamas. So the rajas, tamas, they obstruct this maya shakti, and these sages who transcended these gunas, rajas and tamas, were able to see or experience that power of maya. And thus, this that the maya is a matter of direct experience of certain sages. And that is quoted in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad. And the next verse explains that particular vakya, so gives the meaning of that vakya. Devatma shaktim svagunaihi Devatma shaktim svagunaihi nigudham munayo vidana nigudham munayo vidan parasya shaktir vividha parasya shaktir vividha kriya jnana balatmika kriya jnana balatmika. Devatma shaktim svagunaihi nigudham munayha avidan. Avidan means the new, avindan. Actually, Avindan or Avidan, yeah, they knew. So this Munayah, the sages, they knew the Shakti or the power of Deva. Deva here means Lord or the self-effulgent Lord. They saw that power of Maya, Sagunaihi Nigurham, which actually was Nigurham, which was hidden in the very modifications of Maya. Parasya Shaktihi Vividha. Para Asya Parashaktihi Vividha. Of this Lord, the parashakti of the supreme power is vividha, is manifold. Kriya jnana balatmika. This maya has kriya shakti, jnana shakti, ichha shakti. That this is a very manifold power that this maya of this great Lord has. And this is what the sages saw. Therefore we say that there is a power called maya, which is responsible for the superimposition of the universe upon Brahma. Okay, we'll continue this tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Ishvaro Guru Ratmedi Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyomavad Vyapradehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namaha Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.